Hello everyone, today in this video I will talk about the meconium aspiration syndrome. It is one of the common causes of respiratory distress in newborn. What is the incidence of meconium aspiration? Meconium stain amniotic fluid is found in 10 to 15% of birth and it is usually seen in term and post-term newborn. And its incidence increasing to 25 to 50% in post-term babies. And out of this, 2 to 9% babies develop the meconium aspiration syndrome. 30% of them require the mechanical ventilation and 3 to 5% die due to the complication of meconium aspiration syndrome. Now, how to define meconium stain, meconium aspiration and meconium aspiration syndrome? In this picture, you can see the newborn is having meconium stain umbilical cord. We label as a meconium stain when the umbilical cord, nails and skin are green in color, means meconium stain. But the meconium is present above the vocal cords, that means not aspirated. We label as a meconium aspiration when meconium is present below the vocal cord but not having any respiratory distress. We label as a meconium aspiration syndrome when the meconium is present below the vocal cord with respiratory distress. So these are the various terms we use. Now, how to define the severity of meconium aspiration syndrome? We label as a mild meconium aspiration syndrome when newborn require less than 40% oxygen for less than 48 hours. Moderate, when more than 40% oxygen is needed for more than 48 hours. And severe, when ventilation is required for more than 48 hours and often associated with persistent pulmonary hypertension. What are the risk factors for meconium stain amniotic fluid? There are few maternal risk factor and others are fetal risk factor. So if the mother is having the hypertension, diabetes mellitus, if there is a heavy smoking, and if mother is having placental dysfunction, example abruptio placenti and placenta previa, if mother is having chronic cardiac or respiratory disease, if postterm pregnancy, then chances will be around 25 to 50%. If there is oligohydramnios and if chorioamnionitis, so all these are the risk factor for the meconium stain amniotic fluid. If the fetal distress is present, it will lead to the hypoxia and meconium will be passed. If umbilical cord compression is there, ultimately it will lead to the hypoxic. If presentation is breech, if the IUGR and small for gestation babies, and in preterm baby, if listeriosis infection is present, it will lead to the fetal diarrhea and it is one of the cause of the meconium stain amniotic fluid in preterm baby. Otherwise, meconium stain amniotic fluid is present in term or postterm baby. If it is present in the preterm baby, then you have to rule out the listeriosis infection and the chorioamnionitis in the mother. Why does baby pass the meconium in utero or during the delivery? Normally, fetal bowel has little peristaltic action and the anal sphincter is contracted. But if the baby is having the fetal distress, it will lead to the hypoxia. It causes the anal sphincter to relax and it increases the production of motilin, which promote the intestinal peristalsis. Ultimately, meconium is passed in utero or during the delivery time and lead to the complication of meconium aspiration syndrome. There are several pathophysiological changes occur in meconium aspiration syndrome. Acute airway obstruction can occur. It is depend on the consistency and amount of the meconium which is aspirated, either partial airway obstruction or complete airway obstruction occur. If the obstruction is partial due to valve effect, newborn will develop the hyperinflation or obstructive emphysema or air leak syndrome can develop. Example, pneumothorax, pneumomediastinum can develop. If the obstruction is complete, it will lead to the atelectasis, and ultimately ventilation perfusion mismatch will be there. Due to direct toxic effect of the meconium on lung parenchyma and alveoli, chemical pneumonitis develop. Various inflammatory mediator also release, which further damage the lung tissue. Various substance in the meconium inactivate the endogenous surfactant, and also the cytotoxic effect of the meconium on type 2 pneumocyte lead to the decreased level of surfactant protein A and B. Ultimately, due to the surfactant dysfunction, atelectasis will develop and ventilation perfusion mismatch will be there. Severe meconium aspiration syndrome, persistent pulmonary hypertension can also be developed. It will lead to the right to left shunting. It is due to various inflammatory and vasoconstrictive mediator released into the alveoli, example endothelin 1, PGE2 and leukotrienes. And so patient can develop this complication also. So all these are the pathophysiological changes which can occur in the meconium aspiration syndrome. Now, what are the clinical features of meconium aspiration syndrome? So in this video, you can see the meconium stent, umbilical cord, nail and the skin of the baby. So green yellow staining of the umbilical cord, nails and skin will be present. And if baby has developed the meconium aspiration syndrome, then the sign of respiratory distress in the form of tachypnea, grunting, retraction will be there. It will be present within the first hour of life, and increased enteropositional diameter of the chest will be there because of the hyperinflation and emphysema, which is generally developed in the proximal airway obstruction or partial airway obstruction. Child can develop the apnea, and on auscultation, ronchi and crepitation will be audible. Depend on the severity, meconium aspiration syndrome baby may improve within 72 hours if it is mild to moderate. But when assistant ventilation is required, in severe cases, respiratory distress may persist for many days or even for weeks. And if it is associated with PPHN, then there will be high chances of mortality. Will be investigations we will perform in meconium aspiration syndrome. So chest x-ray, arterial blood gas analysis. We have to rule out the infection by the sepsis screening test and to confirm by blood culture and sensitivity. And routine investigation should be performed and echo should be performed to see the child has developed the PPHN or not. What are the chest x-ray finding in meconium aspiration syndrome? In this x-ray, you can see the child is having the hyperlucent lung field, overexpanded lung field. It is because of the proximal partial airway obstruction. So bilateral hyper aerated lung field is present, and here you can see the opacity. It is due to the atelectasis and consolidation whenever there is a complete distal airway obstruction is there. And here you can see the depressed dome of diaphragm is present because of the hyperinflated lung fields. In this x-ray also you can see the coarse nodular opacities are present in both left and right side. And in this x-ray, you can see the bilateral pneumothorax. It is because of the bulbar effect of the partial obstruction. And this is an example of Ehrlich syndrome. So these are the various characteristic x-ray finding of meconium aspiration syndrome. How to treat the meconium aspiration syndrome? There is supportive treatment and a specific treatment for the MIS. In supportive treatment, give the oxygen, maintain the hydration by maintaining IV flow, maintain the temperature by keeping the baby under retained formula. Stomach wash with normal saline should be given. If showing the sign of severe respiratory distress, keep the baby on mechanical ventilation. If refractory to the mechanical ventilation, then we can give the high frequency ventilation or ECMO. Prophylactic role of the antibiotic is controversial. We can start the antibiotic if newborn is showing any clinical sign of sepsis or if it is confirmed. Correction of acidosis should be done because acidosis causes the pulmonary vasoconstriction and it will complicate with the PPHN. Correction of Ehrlich syndrome should be done. The role of steroid is controversial in meconium aspiration syndrome. In specific treatment for the meconium aspiration syndrome, we have to give the medication for the PPHN. So for this, we can give the inhaled nitric oxide or sildenafil or milrinone or prostacycline or PG even, or we can start the dopamine dolazolin, or if patient is not responding, then we can try the magnesium sulfate. In this, sildenafil is phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor and it dilates the pulmonary vessels, and we generally use this drug in the form of orally in the newborn. Or if patient is not responding, then we can start the injectable milrinone also. If still the patient is not responding, then we can start the prostacycline or we can start the dopamine with dolazolin. Dolazolin is alpha adrenergic antagonist. It dilates the pulmonary vasculature. And if patient is not responding, then we can give the magnesium sulfate also. It also dilates the pulmonary vasculature. So all these drugs are effective in PPHN. And there is the role of exogenous surfactant. As we had discussed that meconium causes the surfactant inactivation. So we can give the exogenous surfactant in meconium aspiration syndrome. How to prevent the meconium aspiration syndrome? For this, optimal antenatal care should be provided to the mother. There is a controversial role of amnio infusion in which the normal saline is injected into the amniotic fluid. So the dilution of the meconium stent amniotic fluid will be there and the chances of developing the MIS will be less. Elective induction of the labor is indicated if there is fetal distress or late fetal heart rate deceleration or poor beat-to-beat fetal heart rate variability, or if more than 41 weeks of pregnancy is there, if chances of postterm, then induction of labor should be done. And at least two skilled persons should be present in the labor room at the time of such type of delivery. The prognosis of meconium aspiration syndrome. There is high incidence of long-term pulmonary problems. 23% of MIS babies require regular bronchodilator therapy for 3 to 6 months. Cough, wheezing, and persistent hyperinflation could be present up to 5 to 10 years of age. And the ultimate prognosis depends on extent of CNS injury. As we know, hypoxia due to the MIS will lead to the birth asphyxia, and they also depend on PPHN. Thank you.